What time is the rehearsal to be?
And you've had a good dinner, too. You'll grant me that.
Possibly good. They don't seem to be ready, do they? Mr. King, I expected to see you transformed by now. You should be half puff at least, sir. You're not even half dressed.
Sheridan, sir, I must speak with you. It is most urgent.
Now,
sir, or the play cannot go forward.
Oh, well.
Second green room, sir. You will.
Very well, sir. But you must be brief. It is late. Now, sir, what is it? Dear God, man, what are you doing? Why have you locked me in?
You see a fire, sir, a chair, two bottles of good claret, and some anchovy sandwiches.
Yes, sir, I see them.
You also see pen and ink in the prompt copy.
Oh, the devil, so I do.
We open The Critic on October the 30th. It is now October the 28th, and we have no ending written. Nor do we have three linking scenes. They are all my scenes, Mr. Sheridan, and I must have them.
And so you shall, my dear fellow, and we shall end with a battle, I promise you.
Tonight, Dick, we must have them tonight. The door stays locked till they're written, if it takes till dawn.
Bart, Lindley, are you part of the plot, too?
The town is coming, Dick. They expect to see The Critic the day after tomorrow. It's time you wrote it.
Yes, my dear fellow, I suppose it is. Well, tell them to play the overture again, and by the time they are perfect, I will be. Now then.
To Lord North. Letter the second on the state of the army. Tja. To the first L-D of the A-Y. Genuine extract of a letter from St. Kitts. Coxheath intelligence. It is now confidently asserted that Sir Charles Hardy pshaw, nothing but about the fleet and the nation. And I hate all politics but theatrical politics. Where's the Morning Chronicle?
Yes, that's your gazette.
So, here we have it. Theatrical intelligence extraordinary. We hear there is a new tragedy in rehearsal at Drury Lane Theatre called The Spanish Armada, said to be written by Mr. Puff, a gentleman well known in the theatrical world. If we may allow ourselves to give credit to the report of the performers, who are, truth to say, in general but indifferent judges, this piece abounds with the most striking and received beauties of modern composition. So, I'm very glad my friend Puff's tragedy is in such forwardness. And my dear, Mrs. Dangle, you'll be very glad to hear that Puff's tragedy...
Lord, Mr. Dangle, why will you plague me about such nonsense? Oh, now the plays are begun, I shall have no peace. Isn't it sufficient to make yourself ridiculous by your passion for the theatre without continually teasing me to join you? Why can't you ride your hobby horse without desiring to place me on a pillion behind you, Mr. Dangle?
Nay, my dear, I was only going to read.
No, what? No, you will never read anything that's worth listening to. You hate to hear about your country. There are letters every day with Roman signatures demonstrating the certainty of an invasion and proving the country is utterly undone. But you never will read anything to entertain one.
Now, what has a woman to do with politics, Mrs. Dangle?
And what have you to do with the theatre, Mr. Dangle? And why should you affect the character of a critic? I have no patience with you. Haven't you made yourself the jest of all your acquaintance by your interference in matters where you have no business? Are you not called a theatrical quidnunc and a mock Maecenas to second-hand authors?
True, my power with the managers is pretty notorious. But is it no credit to have applications from all quarters for my interest? From lords to recommend fiddlers, from ladies to get boxes, from authors to get answers, and from actors to get engagements.
Yes, truly, you have contrived to get a share in all the plague and trouble of theatrical property without the profit, or even the credit of the abuse that attends it.
I'm sure, Mrs. Dangle, you are no loser by it, however. You have all the advantages of it. Mightn't you, last Christmas, have had the reading of the new pantomime a fortnight previous to its performance? And doesn't Mr. Fosbrook let you take places for a play before it is advertised and set you down for a box for every new piece through the season? And didn't my friend, Mr. Smatter, dedicate his last farce to you at my particular request, Mrs. Dangle?
Yes, but wasn't the farce damned, Mr. Dangle? And to be sure, it is extremely pleasant to have one's house made the motley rendezvous of all the lackeys of literature. A very high change of trading authors and jobbing critics. Yes, my drawing room is an absolute register office for candidate actors and poets without character. Then, to be continually alarmed with Mrs. and Mom's piping hysteric changes on Juliet's and Dorinda's, Polly's and Ophelia's, and the very furniture trembling with the probationary starts and unprovoked rants of would-be Richards and Hamlets, and what is worse than all, now that the manager has monopolized the opera house, haven't we the signors and signoras calling here, sliding their smooth semi-breves and gargling glib divisions in their outlandish throats, with foreign emissaries and French spies, for aught I know, disguised like fiddlers and figure dancers?
Mercy, Mrs. Dangle.
And to employ yourself so idly at such an alarming crisis as this, too. When if you had the least spirit, you would have been at the head of one of the Westminster associations or trailing a volunteer pike on the artillery ground. But you, oh, my conscience, I believe if the French were landed tomorrow, your first inquiry would be whether they had brought a theatrical troupe with them.
Mrs. Dangle, it does not signify. I say the stage is the mirror of nature and the actors are the abstract and brief chronicles of the time. And pray, what could a man of sense study better? Besides, you will not easily persuade me that there is no credit or importance in being at the head of a band of critics. Take upon them to decide for the whole town, whose opinion and patronage all writers solicit, and whose recommendations no manager dares refuse.
Oh, ridiculous! Both managers and authors of the least merit laugh at your pretensions. The public is their critic, without whose fair approbation they know no play can rest on the stage, and with whose applause they welcome such attacks as yours, and laugh at the malice of them where they can't at the wit.
Very well, madam, very well.
Mr. Sneer, sir, to wait on you.
Ah, show Mr. Sneer up. Plague-ot. Now we must appear loving and affectionate, or Sneer will hitch us into a story.
With all my heart, you can't be more ridiculous than you are.
You are enough to provoke consent. My dear Sneer, I'm vastly glad to see you. My dear, here's Mr. Sneer.
Good morning to you, sir.
Yeah, Mrs. Dangle and I have been diverting ourselves with the papers. Please, Sneer, Won't you go to Drury Lane Theatre, the first night of Buff's tragedy?
Yes, but I suppose one shan't be able to get in, for on the first night of a new play, they always paper the house with orders to support it. But here, Dangle, I brought you two pieces, one of which you must exert yourself to make the managers accept. I can tell you that, for it is written by a person of consequence.
So, now my plagues are beginning.
I'm glad of it, for now you'll be happy. Why, my dear Dangle, it is a pleasure to see how you enjoy your volunteer fatigue and your solicited solicitations.
It's a great trouble. Getty gab, it's pleasant too. Why, sometimes of a morning I have a dozen people call on me at breakfast time whose faces I never saw before, nor ever desire to see again.
That must be very pleasant indeed.
And not a week, but I get a 50 letters, not a line in them about any business of my own.
An amusing correspondence.
Bursts into tears and exit. What? Is this a tragedy?
No, that's a genteel comedy, not a translation, only taken from the French. It is written in a style which they've lately tried to run down. The true sentimental. And nothing ridiculous in it from the beginning to the end.
Well, if they had kept to that, I should not be such an enemy to the stage. There was some edification to be got from pieces of that sort, Mr. Sneer.
I am quite of your opinion, Mrs. Dangle. The theatre, in proper hands, might certainly be made the school of morality. But now, I am sorry to say it. People seem to go there principally for their entertainment.
It would have been more to the credit of the managers to have kept it in the other line.
Undoubtedly, madam, and hereafter perhaps to have had it recorded, that in the midst of a luxurious and dissipated age, they preserved two houses in the capital where the conversation was always moral, at least, if not entertaining.
Now, I think the worst alteration is in the nicety of the audience. No double entendre, no smart innuendo admitted. Even Vanborough and Congreve obliged to undergo a bungling reformation.
Yes, and our prudery in this respect is just on a par with the artificial bashfulness of a courtesan who increases the blush upon her cheek in an exact proportion to the diminution of her modesty.
Sneer can't even give the public a good word. Yes, but what have we here? This seems very odd.
Oh, that's a comedy. On a very new plan. Replete with wit and mirth. Yet of a most serious moral. You see, it is called The Reformed Housebreaker, where, by the mere force of humor, housebreaking is put into so ridiculous a light that if the piece has its proper run, I have no doubt but that bolts and bars will be entirely useless by the end of the season.
This is new indeed.
Yes, it's written by a particular friend of mine, who has discovered that the follies and foibles of society are subjects unworthy the notice of the comic muse, who should be taught to stoop only at the greater vices and blacker crimes of humanity, gibbeting capital offences in five acts, or pillorying petty larcenies in two. In short, his idea is to dramatise the penal laws and make the stage a court of ease to the Old Bailey.
It is truly moral.
Sir Fretful Plagiary, sir. Oh.
Beg him to walk up. Now, Mrs. Dangle, Sir Fretful Plagiary is an author to your own taste.
I confess he is a favourite of mine because everybody else abuses him.
Very much to the credit of your charity, madam, if not of your judgment.
But egad, he allows no merit to any author but himself. That's the true fault. Though he is my friend.
Never.
Oh,
he's as envious as an old maid verging on the desperation of 36. And then the insidious humility with which he seduces you to give a free opinion of any of his works can be exceeded only by the petulant arrogance with which he is sure to reject your observations.
That's very true. Yeah, though he is my friend.
And then his affected contempt of all newspaper strictures, though at the same time he's the sorest man alive and shrinks like scorched parchment from the fiery ordeal of true criticism. Yet is he so covetous of popularity that he'd rather be abused than not mentioned at all.
There's no denying it. But though he is my friend.
You've read the tragedy he has just finished, haven't you?
Yes, he sent it to me yesterday.
Well, and you think it execrable, don't you?
Why, egad, between ourselves, I must own, though he is my friend, that it is one of theme. He's here. Finished an admirable performance.
Sneer with him, did you say?
My dear friend! We were just talking of your tragedy. Oh. Admirable, Sir Fretful, admirable.
You never did anything beyond it, Sir Fretful. Never in your life.
You make me extremely happy. For without a compliment, my dear Sneer, there isn't a man in the world whose judgment I value as I do yours. Oh. And Mr. Dangle's.
They are only laughing at you, Sir Fretful, for it was but just now.
Mrs. Dangle, Oh, it's a riddle you know, Mrs. Dangle. My friend Smear was rallying just now. He knows how she admires you and...
Oh, Lord. I'm sure Mr. Smear has more taste and sincerity than a damn double-faced fellow.
Yes, yes, Smear will jest, but a better nature...
Oh, I know.
Yes, he has a ready turn for ridicule. His wit costs him nothing.
No, egad, or I should wonder how he came by it.
Because his jest is always at the expense of his friend.
About Sir Fretful, have you sent your play to the managers yet, or may I be of any service to you?
No, no, I thank you. I believe the piece had sufficient recommendation in it. I thank you, though. I sent it to the manager of Covent Garden Theatre this morning.
I should have thought now it might have been cast, as the actors call it. Better by Mr. Sheridan at Drury Lane.
Oh, no! Never send a play there while I live! Harky!
Writes himself. I know he does.
I say nothing. I take away from no man's merit. I'm hurt by no man's good fortune. I say nothing. But this I will say. Through all my knowledge of life, I have observed there is not a passion so strongly rooted in the human heart as envy.
I believe you have reason for what you say, indeed.
Besides, I can tell you it is not always so safe to leave a play in the hands of those who write themselves.
What? They may steal from them? Hey, my dear plagiarist.
Steal? To be sure they may. And egad, serve up your best thoughts as gypsies do their stolen children. Disfigure them to make a pass for their own.
But your present work is a sacrifice to Melpomene. And Sheridan, you know...
That's no security. A dexterous plagiarist may do anything. Why, sir, for aught I know, he might take out some of the best things in my tragedy and put them into his own comedy.
That might be done, I dare be sworn.
And then if such a fellow offers you the least help or assistance or a hint, he's devilish apt to take the merit for the whole.
If it succeeds.
But with regard to this piece, I think I can hit that gentleman, for I can safely swear he never read it.
I'll tell you how you may hurt him more.
How?
Swear he wrote it.
Plague on now, Sneer. I shall take it ill. I believe you want to take away my character as an author.
Then I'm sure you ought to be very obliged to me.
Pray, sir.
You know he never means what he says.
Sincerely, then. You do like the piece?
Wonderfully.
Come now, there must be something you think might be mended, eh? Mr. Dangle, has nothing struck you?
My faith it is, but an ungracious thing for the most part to...
Oh, yes, it is, just so indeed. They are in general strangely tenacious. But for my part, I'm never so well pleased as when a judicious critic can point out any defect to me. For what is the purpose of showing a work to a friend if you don't mean to profit by his opinion?
Very true. Why then, though I seriously admire the piece upon the whole, there is one small objection, which, if you give me leave, I'll mention.
Sir, you can't oblige me more.
I think it wants incident.
Good God. You surprised me. Once. Incident?
Yes, I own it. I think the incident's too few.
Good God! Believe me, Mr. Sneer, there is no person for whose judgment I have a more implicit deference. But I protest to you, Mr. Sneer, I'm only apprehensive that the incidents are too crowded. My dear Dangle, how does it strike you?
Well, I can't agree with my friend Sneer. I think the plot quite sufficient, and the four first acts, by many degrees, the best I ever read or saw in my life. If I might venture to suggest anything, it is that the interest rather falls off in the fifth.
Rises, I believe you mean, sir.
No, I don't, upon my word.
Yes, yes, you do, upon my soul. It certainly don't fall off, I can tell you. No, no. But don't fall off.
Mrs. Dangle, didn't you say that it struck you in the same light?
No, indeed I did not. I did not see a fault in any part of the play from the beginning to the end.
Upon my soul, the women are the best judges after all.
Or if I had any objection, I'm sure it was to nothing in the piece, but that I was afraid it was, on the whole, a little too long.
Pray, madam, do you speak as to duration of time? Or do you mean that the story is tediously spun out?
Oh, lud, no. I speak only with reference to the usual length of acting plays.
Then I'm very happy. Very happy indeed. Because the play is a short play. A remarkably short play. I should not venture to differ with the lady on a point of taste, but on these occasions, the watch, you know, is the critic.
Then I suppose it must have been Mr. Dangle's drawling manner of reading it to me.
Oh, if Mr. Dangle read it, that's quite another affair. But I can assure you, Mr. Dangle, the first evening you can spare me 3 hours and a half, I'll undertake to read you the whole from beginning to end, with the prologue and the epilogue, and allow time for the music between the acts.
I hope to see it on the stage next.
Well, Sir Redfall, I hope you may be able to get rid as easily of the newspaper criticisms as you do of ours.
The newspapers. Sir, they are the most villainous, licentious, abominable, not that I ever read them. No. I make it a rule never to look into a newspaper.
You are quite right, for it certainly must hurt a writer of delicate feelings to see the liberties they take.
No, quite the contrary. Their abuse is, in fact, the best panegyric. I like it above all things. An author's reputation is only in danger from their support.
Well, that's true. And that attack now on you the other day.
What? Where?
Oh, you mean in a paper of Thursday. It was completely ill-natured, to be sure.
Oh, so much the better. I wouldn't have it otherwise.
Certainly it is only to be laughed at for one.
You wouldn't happen to recollect what the fellow said.
Oh, pray, Dangle. Sir Fredful seems a little anxious.
Oh, no, no. Anxious? No, not I. Not in the least. I might as well hear, you know.
Sneer, can you recollect? Make out something.
I will. Yes, yes, I remember perfectly.
Well, then, pray, then. Not that it signified. What might the gentleman say?
Why, he roundly asserts that you have not the slightest invention or original genius whatever, though you are the greatest producer of all other authors living.
Very good.
There's the comedy. You have not one idea of your own, he believes. Even in your commonplace book, where stray jokes and pilfered witticisms are kept with as much method as the ledger of the lost and stolen office. Nay, you are so unlucky as not to have the skill even to steal with taste, but that you glean from the refuse of obscure volumes where more judicious plagiarists have been before you, so that the body of your work is a composition of dregs and sediment, like a bad tavern's worst wine. In your more serious efforts, he says, your bombast would be less intolerable if the thoughts were ever suited to the expression. But the homeliness of the sentiment stares through the fantastic encumbrance of its fine language like a clown in one of the new uniforms. That your occasional tropes and flowers suit the general coarseness of your style, as embroidery would a ground of sackcloth, while your imitations of Shakespeare resemble the mimicry of Falstaff's page and are about as near the standard of the original. In short, that even the finest passages you steal are of no service to you, for the poverty of your own language prevents their assimilating, so that they lie on the surface like lumps of marl on a barren moor, encumbering what it is not in their power to fertilize.
Now, another person would be vexed at this.
Oh, but I wouldn't have told you only to divert.
Oh, I know. And I am diverted. Not the least in revenge.
Good, very good. Yes, no genius.
A severe rogue. Yeah, but you are quite right, Sir Fretful, never to read such nonsense.
To be sure. But if there's anything to one's praise, it is foolish vanity to be pleased at it. And if it's abuse, why, one is always sure to hear of it from one damn good-natured friend or another.
Sir, there's an Italian gentleman with a French interpreter and two young ladies and four musicians who say they're sent by Lady Rondeau and Mrs. Few.
Gad, so they come by appointment. Dear Mrs. Dangle, do let them know. I'll see them directly.
No, Mr. Dangle, I shan't understand a word they say.
But you hear, there's an interpreter.
Well, I'll try to endure their complaisance till you come.
And Mr. Puff, sir, sent word that the last rehearsal is to be this morning and that he'll call on you presently.
Very true. I shall certainly be at home. Now, Sir Fretful, if you have a mind to have justice done you in way of answer, egad, Mr. Puff's your man.
Oh, sir, why should I wish to have it answered when I tell you that I'm pleased at it?
Oh, true, I had forgot that. But I hope you're not fettered at what Mr. Sneer...
No, Mr. Dangle. Don't I tell you these things don't fret me in the least?
Nay, I only thought...
And let me tell you, Mr. Dangle, it is damned affronting in you to suppose that I'm hurt when I tell you that I'm not!
But why so warm, Sir Fred?
Damn life, Mr. Sneer! You're as absurd as Dangle! How often do I have to repeat it to you that nothing can vex me, but you're supposing it possible for me to mind the damned nonsense you've been repeating to me? And let me tell you, if you continue to believe this, you must mean to insult me. And then your disrespect will affect me no more than the newspaper criticisms. And I shall treat it with exactly the same calm indifference and philosophic contempt. And so your servant.
Now will you go and vent his philosophy in anonymous abuse of all modern critics and authors? Oh. But Dangle, we must get your friend Puff to take me to the rehearsal of his tragedy.
Egad, I'll answer for it. He'll thank you for desiring it. But come and help me judge of this musical family. They are recommended by people of consequence, I assure you.
I'm at your disposal the whole morning, but I had thought you had been a decided critic in music as well as in literature.
So I am, but I have a bad ear. If fate's near, though, I am afraid we were a little too severe on Sir Fretful, though he is my friend.
Why, it is certain that unnecessarily to mortify the vanity of any writer is a cruelty which mere dullness never can deserve. But where a base and personal malignity usurps the place of literary emulation, the aggressor deserves neither quarter nor pity.
That's very true, egad. Though he is my friend.
Je dis, madame, j'ai l'honneur.
I say again, gentlemen, I don't understand a word you say.
Questo signore spiegherà.
Oui, me interpret. Nous avons des recommandations pour Monsieur Dangle de madame.
Upon my word, sir. I don't understand you.
La Contessa Rondeau è nostra padrona.
Si, padre, and my lady fool. Oh.
Ah, voici Monsieur Dangle.
Ah, Signor Dangle.
Mr. Dangle, here are two very civil gentlemen trying to make themselves understood, and I don't know which one is the interpreter.
Oh, stop. Eh bien.
Monsieur Dangle, le bon but de votre talent pour la critique, avec le monsieur de l'intérêt de la théâtre.
D'accord. Egad, I think the interpreter is the hardest to be understood of the two.
Why, my dear Dangle, I thought you had been an admirable linguist.
So I am, if they wouldn't talk so damn fast.
Well, I'll explain that. The less time we lose in hearing them, the better. For that, I suppose, is what they are brought here for.
Monsieur, mademoiselle! Pas plus vite, pas plus vite. Vous voulez chanter et jouer, je suppose?
Si, si. Oui.
Bon. Madame. Oui. Comment?
Oui. S'il vous plaît. One, two, three, four.
One, two, three, four.
Je suis sorti de mon pays pour jouer de ma guitare. Je suis sorti de mon pays pour jouer de ma guitare. Qui fait ta-ta-ta, qui fait ta-ta-ta, qui fait ta-ta-ta, qui fait ta.
Qui fait ta-ta-ta, qui fait ta-ta-ta, qui fait ta-ta-ta, qui fait ta-ta-ta.
nom d'ici m'appelle, toujours pas le nom de ma jolie guitare. Tout le monde ici m'appelle, toujours pas le nom de ma jolie guitare. Il fait tin tin tin, il fait tin tin tin, il fait tin tin tin, il fait Nanette, un jour me dit, mon cœur joue un peu de ta belle guitare. Nanette, un jour me dit, mon cœur joue un peu de ta belle guitare. Qui fait tin, 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 qui fait tin, 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 qui fait tin, 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 qui fait ta.
Where will you hear such as these voices in England?
Not easily.
But Puff is coming. Signora and little signoras are brigantissimo. Sposa, signora Donglena. Mrs. Dangle, shall I beg you to offer them some refreshment and take their address in the next room?
Would you come this way, please? Which way? Darling. Come along.
Admirable.
This way.
Mr. Puff, sir.
My dear Puff!
My dear Dangle, how is it with you?
Mr. Steer, give me leave to introduce Mr. Puff to you.
Mr. Sneer is this, sir. He's a gentleman whom I've long panted for the honour of knowing. A gentleman whose critical talents and transcendent judgment...
Yes, sir. Oh, everybody, Sneer, my friend Puff only speaks to you in the style of his profession.
His profession?
Yes, sir, I make no secret of the trade I follow among friends and brother authors. Dangle knows I love to be frank on the subject and to advertise myself viva voce. I am, sir, a practitioner in panegyric. Or to speak more plainly, a professor of the art of puffing at your service, or anybody else's.
Sir, you are very obliging. I believe, Miss Puff, I've often admired your talents in the daily print.
Ah, why, yes, I flatter myself I do as much business in that way as any six of the fraternity in town. Mm. Devilish hard work all summer, friend Dangle. Never worked harder. But, harky, the winter managers were a little sore, I believe. No, I think they took it all in good part.
Aye,
then that must have been affectation in them, for egad, there were some of the attacks there was no laughing at.
The humorous ones. I mean, I should think, Mr. Baff, that authors would, in general, be able to do this sort of work for themselves.
Why, yes, but in a clumsy way. Besides, we look on that as an encroachment, and so take the opposite side. Oh. I dare say now, you conceive half the very civil paragraphs and advertisements you see to be written by the parties concerned or their friends. No such thing. 9 out of 10 manufactured by me in the way of business.
Indeed. But pray, Mr. Puff, what first put you on exercising your talents in this way?
Egad's a sheer necessity. You must know, Mr. Sneer, that from the first time I tried my hand at an advertisement, my success was such that for some time after I led the most extraordinary life indeed.
How, pray?
Sir, I supported myself 2 years entirely by my misfortunes.
By your misfortunes?
Yes, sir. Assisted by long sickness and other occasional disorders, and a very comfortable living I had of it.
From sickness and misfortunes? You practiced as a doctor and an attorney at once.
No, egad! Both maladies and miseries were my own.
Hey, what the plague?
It's true. Hockey by advertisements to the charitable and humane, and to those whom Providence hath blessed with affluence.
Oh, I understand you.
And in truth, I deserve what I got, for I suppose never man went through such a series of calamities in the same space of time. Sir, I was 5 times made a bankrupt and reduced from a state of affluence by a train of unavoidable misfortunes. Then, sir, though a very industrious tradesman, I was 2x burnt out and lost my little all both times. I lived upon those fires a month. I soon after was confined by a most excruciating disorder and lost the use of my limbs. Oh. Well, that told very well, for I had the case strongly attested and went about to collect the subscriptions myself. Egad, I believe that was when you first called on me. In November last. Oh, no, I was then a close prisoner in the Marshalsea. Oh. For a debt, benevolently contracted to serve a friend. Uh-huh. I was afterwards 2x tapped for a dropsy, which declined into a very profitable consumption. I was... Then I became a widow with 6 helpless children. Having had 11 husbands pressed and being left every time, 8 months gone with child and no money to get me into hospital.
And you bore all with patience, I make no doubt.
Why, yes. Though I made some occasional attempts at fellow de se, but as I did not find those rash actions answer, I left off killing myself pretty soon. Well, sir, at last, what with the bankruptcies, gouts, fires, dropsies, and other valuable calamities, having got together a pretty handsome sum, I determined to quit a business which had always rather gone against my conscience. And in a more liberal way, still to indulge my talents for fiction and embellishment through my favorite channels of diurnal communication. And so, sir, you have my history.
Most obligingly communicative indeed. But surely, Mr. Path, there is no great mystery in your present profession.
Mystery? Sir, I will take it upon me to say that the matter was never scientifically treated nor reduced to rule before.
Reduced to rule?
Oh, sir, you are very ignorant, I am afraid. Yes, sir, puffing is of various sorts. The principal are the puff direct, the puff preliminary, the puff collateral, the puff collusive, and the puff oblique. The puff by implication.
The puff direct, I can conceive.
Oh, yes. That's simple enough. For instance, a new comedy or farce is to be produced at one of the theatres. Though, by the by, they don't bring out half what they ought to. The author, suppose Mr. Smatter or Mr. Dapper or any particular friend of mine. Very well.
The
day before it is to be performed, I write an account of the manner in which it was received. Ooh. Well, I have the plot from the author, and only add characters strongly drawn, mind of invention, hand of a master. Then for the performance, Mr. Dodd was astonishingly great in the role of Sir Harry. That universal and judicious actor, Mr. Palmer, perhaps never appeared to more advantage than in the Colonel. But it is not in the power of language to do justice to Mr. King. Indeed, he more than merited those repeated bursts of applause which he drew from a most brilliant and judicious audience. As to the scenery, the miraculous powers of Mr. de Lutherbourg's pencil are universally acknowledged. In short, we are at a loss which to admire most. The unrivaled genius of the author, the wonderful abilities of the painter, or the incredible exertions of all the performers.
That's pretty well indeed, sir.
Oh, cool. Quite cool. To what I sometimes do.
And do you think there are any who are influenced by this?
Oh, Lord, yes, sir. The number of those who go through the fatigue of judging for themselves is very small indeed.
Well, sir, the puff preliminary.
Now, that, sir, does well in the form of a caution. In a matter of gallantry now, Sir Flimsy Gossamer wishes to be well with Lady Fanny Fate. He applies to me. I open trenches for him with a paragraph in the Morning Post. It is recommended to the beautiful and accomplished Lady F, 4 stars F-E, to be on her guard against that most dangerous character, Sir F-G, who, however pleasing and insinuating his manners may be, is certainly not remarkable for the constancy of his attachments, in italics. Here now, you see, Sir Flimsy Gossamer is introduced to the particular notice of Lady Fanny, who perhaps never thought of him before. She finds herself publicly cautioned to avoid him, which naturally makes her desirous of seeing him. Which, if Sir Flimsy is unable to improve upon, he at least gains the credit of having their names mentioned together by a particular set and in a particular way, which, 9 times out of 10, is the full accomplishment of modern gallantry.
Egad, Sneer, you will be quite an adept in the business.
Now, sir, the puff collateral is much used as an appendage to advertisements and may take the form of an anecdote. Yesterday, as the celebrated George Bonmot was sauntering down St. James's Street, he met the lively Lady Mary Myrtle coming out of the park. Good God, Lady Mary! I'm surprised to see you in a white jacket, for I never expected to have seen you but in a full twinned uniform and light horseman's cap. Heavens, George, where could you have learned that? Why, replied the wit, I just saw a print of you in a new publication called The Camp Magazine, which, by the by, is a devilishly clever thing. And he's sold at number 3 on the right hand of the way, 2 doors from the printing office, the corner of Ivy Lane, Paternoster Row. Price only 1 shilling.
That's very ingenious indeed.
But the puff collusive is the newest of any, for it acts in the disguise of determined hostility. An indignant correspondent observes that the new poem called Beelzebub's Cotillion, or Proserpine's Fête Champêtre, is one of the most unjustifiable performances he ever read. The shameful avidity by which this piece is brought by all people of fashion is a reproach on the taste of the times and a disgrace to the delicacy of the age. Here now, you see, the 2 strongest inducements are held forth. First, that nobody ought to read it. And secondly, that everybody... On the strength of which the publisher boldly prints the 10th edition before he'd sold 10 of the first.
Oh, God, I know it is so.
As to the puff oblique, or puff by implication, it is too various and extensive to be illustrated by an instance. It has a wonderful memory for parliamentary debates and will often give you the whole speech of a favored member with the most flattering accuracy. But above all, it is a great dealer in reports and suppositions. It can hint a riband for implied services in the air of a common report, and with the carelessness of a casual paragraph, suggest officers into commands to which they have no pretension but their own wishes. This, sir, is the last principal class in the art of puffing. An art which I hope you will now agree with me is of the highest dignity.
Sir, I am completely a convert, both to the importance and the ingenuity of your profession.
Now, sire, there is but one thing that can possibly increase my respect for you, and that is your permission to be present this morning at the rehearsal of your new...
You hush! For heaven's sake! My tragedy? Egad, Dangle, I take this very ill. You know how apprehensive I am of being known to be the author.
Well, in faith, I would not have told, but it's in the papers, and your name at length, in the Morning Chronicle.
Ah, those damned editors never can keep a secret. Well, Mr. Sneer, no doubt you will do me great honour. I shall be infinitely happy. Highly flattered.
Oh, I believe it must be the other time. Shall we go together?
No, it will not yet be this hour, for they are always late at that theatre. Besides, I must meet you there, for I have some little matters here to send to the papers. Yes, and a few paragraphs to scribble before I go. Here is a conscientious baker on the subject of the army bread. No. And a detester of visible brickwork in favor of the new invented stucco. Oh. Both in the style of Junius and promised for tomorrow. So, I must do that in the evening papers or reserve it for the Morning Herald. For I know, too, that I have undertaken tomorrow besides to establish the unanimity of the fleet in the Public Advertiser and to shoot Charles Fox in the Morning Post. So, egad, I had a moment to lose.
Well, then, we will meet in the green room.
Might be better applied to the purpose of plays. They ought to be the abstract and brief chronicles of the time. Therefore, when history, and particularly the history of our own country, furnishes anything like a case in point to the time in which an author writes, if he knows his own interest, he will take advantage of it. So, sir, I call my tragedy the Spanish Armada, and have laid the scene before Tilbury Fort.
A most happy thought, certainly.
Egad, it was. I told you so. But pray now, I don't understand how you've contrived to introduce any love into it.
Love? Oh, nothing so easy, for it is a received point among poets that where history gives you a good heroic outline for a play, you may fill up with a little love at your own discretion. In doing which, 9 times out of 10, you only make up a deficiency in the private history of the times. Now, I rather think I have done this with some success.
No scandal about Queen Elizabeth, I hope.
Oh, that, no, no. I only suppose the governor of Tilbury Fort's daughter to be in love with the son of the Spanish admiral.
Oh, is that all?
Excellent, if faith, I see it at once. But won't this appear rather improbable?
Oh, to be sure it will, but what the plague! A play's not to show occurrences that happen every day, but things just so strange that though they never did happen, they might happen.
Certainly nothing is unnatural that is not physically impossible.
Very true, and for that matter, Don Farolo Whiskerandos, for that is the lover's name, might have been over here in the train of the Spanish ambassador. Or Tilburina, for that is the lady's name, might have been in love with him from having seen his picture, or heard of his character, or from knowing that he was the last man in the world she ought to be in love with, or for any other good female reason. But the fact is, sir, egad, though she is but a knight's daughter, she is in love like any princess.
Poor young lady, I feel for her already, for I can conceive how great the conflict must be between her passion and her duty, her love for her country and her love for Don Farolo Whiskerandos.
Oh, amazing, yes, her poor susceptible heart is swayed to and fro by contending passions. Duty for
the scene is set and everything is ready to begin, if you please, sir.
Gad, then we'll lose no time.
Though I believe, sir, you will find it very short. For all the performers have profited by the kind permission that you granted them.
Hey, what?
Well, you know, sir, you gave them leave to cut out or omit whatever they found heavy or unnecessary to the plot. And I must own they've taken most liberal advantage of your indulgence.
Well, well. They are, in general, very good judges, and I know I am luxuriant. Now then, Mr. Hopkins, as soon as you please.
Gentlemen, would you play a few bars or something?
Aye, that's right, for as we have the scenes and dresses, in that we'll go to it as if it was a first night performance. But you need not mind stopping them between acts. So, stand clear, gentlemen. Hats off!
Hats off!
Silence! Then up curtain, and let us see what our painters have done for us.
Tilbury Fort. Very fine indeed.
And what do you think I open with?
Faith, I can't guess.
A clock. Hark. I open with a clock striking to beget an awful attention in the audience. It also marks the time, which is 4 o'clock in the morning, and saves a description of the rising sun and a great deal about gilding the eastern hemisphere.
But pray, are the sentinels to be asleep?
Fast as watchmen.
Isn't that odd, though, at such an alarming crisis?
To be sure it is, but smaller things must give way to a striking scene at the opening. That's a rule. And the case is, the two great men are coming to this very spot to begin the piece. Now, it is not to be supposed they would open their lips if these fellows were watching them. So, egad, I must either have them sent off their watch or set them asleep.
That accounts for it. But tell us, who are these coming?
These are they, Sir Walter Raleigh and Sir Christopher Hatton. Now, you will know Sir Christopher by his turning out of his toes. Famous, you know, for his dancing. Yes, I like to preserve all the little traits of character. Now, attend.
True, gallant Raleigh.
What?
They have been talking before.
Oh, yes, all the way as they came along. I beg pardon, gentlemen, but these are particular friends of mine, Mr. Dangle and Mr. Sneer, whose remarks may be of great interest to us.
Yes, sir. Just
don't mind interrupting them if anything strikes you. No.
True, gallant Raleigh, but oh, thou champion of thy country's fame, there is a question which I yet must ask, a question which I never asked before. What mean these mighty armaments, this general muster, and this throng of chiefs?
Well, Mr. Puff, how came Sir Christopher Hatton never to ask that question before?
What, before the play began? How the play could he?
That's true, Faith.
But you will hear what he thinks of the matter.
Alas, my noble friend, when I behold yon dented plains in martial symmetry arrayed, when I count o'er yon glittering lines of crested warriors where the proud steeds neigh, and valor-breathing trumpets' shrill appeal responsive vibrate in my listening ear, when virgin majesty herself I view, like to hope protecting Paris veiled in steel, with graceful confidence exhort to arms! When, briefly, all I hear or see bear stamp of martial vigilance and stern defense, I cannot but surmise, forgive me, friend, if the conjecture's rash, I cannot but surmise, the state some danger apprehends.
A very cautious conjecture, that.
Yes, that's his character. Never to give an opinion, but on secure grounds. Now then.
Oh, most accomplished Christopher.
He calls him by his Christian name to show that they are on the most familiar terms.
Oh, most accomplished Christopher. I find thy staunch sagacity still tracks the future in the fresh print of the o'ertaken past.
Figurative.
My fears are just. Ha! But where, whence, when, and what the danger is, methinks I fain would learn. You know, my friend, scarce 2 revolving suns and 3 revolving moons have closed their course since haughty Philip, in despite of peace, with hostile hand, hath struck at England's trade. I know it well. Philip, you know, is proud Iberia's king. He is. His subjects in base bigotry and Catholic oppression held, while we, you know, the Protestant persuasion hold. We do. You know, beside, his boasted armament, the famed armada, by the Pope baptized, with purpose to invade these realms, is sailed. Last advice is so, report. Whilst the Iberian admiral's chief hope, his darling son, Tirolo Whiskerandos, height? The same. My chance, a prisoner hath been ta'en, and in this fort of Tilbury
is now confined, 'tis true. And oft from yon tall turret's top, I've marked the youthful Spaniard's haughty mien, and conquered, though in chains.
You also know!
Is it a puff as he knows all this? Why does Sir Walter go on telling him?
But the audience are not supposed to know anything of the matter, are they?
Yes, but I think you manage ill, for there certainly seems no reason why Sir Walter should be so communicative.
Poor cat, now! That is one of the most ungrateful observations I ever heard. For the less inducement he has to tell all this, the more I think you ought to be obliged to him. For I am sure you know nothing of the matter without it.
That's very true, upon my word.
But you will find he was not going on.
Enough, enough. 'Tis plain, and I no more am in amazement lost.
Yeah, now you see, Sir Christopher did not in fact ask any one question for his own information.
Yes, indeed. His has been a most disinterested curiosity.
Really, I find we are very much obliged to them both.
To be sure you are. Now then, for the commander-in-chief, the Earl of Leicester, who, you know, was no favorite but of the Queen's. Oh. Yes. We left off in amazement lost.
Am in amazement lost. But see, when noble Leicester comes, supreme in honors and commands.
And yet, methinks, at such a time, so perilous, so feared, that staff might well become an abler grasp.
And so, by heaven, think I. But soft, he's here.
Aye, they envy him.
But who are these with him?
Oh, very valiant knights. That one is the governor of the fort, the other, the master of the horse. And now, gentlemen, I think you will hear some better language. For I was obliged to be plain and intelligible in the first scene because there was so much matter of fact in it. But now, i'faith, you have trope, figure, and metaphor as plentiful as noun substantive.
How's this, my friends? It's thus your new-fled zeal and plumed valor moults in rooted sloth. Why dimly glimmers that heroic flame whose reddening blaze by patriot spirit fed should be the beacon of a kindling realm? Can the quick current of a patriot heart thus stagnate in a cold and weedy converse, or freeze in tideless inactivity? No! Rather, let the fountain of your valor spring through each stream of enterprise, each petty channel of conducive daring, till the full torrent of your foaming wrath o'erwhelm the flax of sunk hostility.
There it is, followed up.
No more! The freshening breath of thy rebuke hath filled the swelling canvas of our souls! And thus, though fate should cut the cable of our topmost hopes, in friendship's closing line, we'll grapple with despair. And if we fall, we fall in glory's wake. Thus spoke old England's genius. Then are we all resolved?
We are all resolved!
To conquer or be free?
To conquer or be free!
Mem Carnegat.
Yes, where they do agree on the stage, their unanimity is...
Then let's embrace. And now...
What the plague, is he going to pray?
Yes, shh! In emergencies, there is nothing like a prayer.
Oh, mighty Mars!
Why should he pray to Mars?
Shh!
If in thy homage bred each point of discipline I've still observed, nor but by due promotion and the right of service to the rank of Major General have arisen, assist thy votary now.
Then do not rise.
Hear me.
And me.
And me.
And me.
And me.
Now pray all together.
Behold thy votary's submissive vain, that thou will deign to grant them all they ask, assist them to accomplish all their ends, and sanctify whatever means they use to gain them.
A very orthodox quintetto.
Vastly well, gentlemen! Is that well managed or not? Have you such a prayer as that on the stage?
Not exactly.
But, sir, you haven't settled how we're to get off here.
Ah, you could not go off kneeling, could you?
No, couldn't.
No, sir, quite impossible.
Oh, it would have a good effect if Aiden could. Yes, exeunt praying, and would vary the established mode of springing off with a glance at the pit.
Never mind, so as you get them off, I'll answer for it. The audience won't care how.
Very well, then, repeat the last line standing and, go off the old way.
And sanctify whatever means we use to gain it. And sanctify whatever means we use to gain it.
Bravo! Fine exit!
Well, really, Mr. Papa.
Stay a moment.
All this shall to Lord Burley's ear.
Tis meet, it should.
Hey, what? I thought these fellows had been asleep.
Only a pretense, there's the art of it. They were spies of Lord Burley's.
Isn't it odd, though? They were never taken notice of, not even by the Commander-in-Chief.
No, yet, sir, if people who wanted listen or overhear were not always connived at in a tragedy, there would be no carrying on any plot in the world.
That's very true, upon my word.
Yes, but take care, my dear Dangle. The morning gun is about to fire.
Oh! Well, that will have a fine effect.
I think so. Helps to realize the scene. What the plague? Three morning guns? There never is but one. Aye, this is always the way in the theatre. Give these fellows a good thing, they never know when to have done with it. You have no more cannon to fire?
No, sir.
Now then, for soft music.
Pray, what's that for?
Shows Tilburina is coming. Nothing introduces you a heroine like soft music. Here she comes.
With her confidant, I suppose.
To be sure, here they are, inconsolable to the minuet in Ariadne.
As the whispering breath of gentle morn bade nature's voice and nature's beauty rise, while orient Phoebus with unborrowed hues clothes the waked loveliness which all night slept in heavenly drapery. Darkness is fled. Now flowers unfold their beauties to the sun and blushing kiss the beam he sends to wake them. The striped carnation and the guarded rose, the vulgar wallflower and smart gillyflower, the polyanthus mean, the dapper daisy, sweet William and sweet marjoram, and all the tribe of single and of double pinks. Now, too, the feathered warblers tune their notes around and charm the listening grove. The lark, the linnet, chaffinch, bullfinch, goldfinch, greenfinch. But oh, to me no joy can they afford, nor rose, nor wallflower, nor smart gillyflower, nor polyanthus mean, nor dapper daisy, nor William sweet, nor marjoram, nor lark, linnet, nor all the finches of the grove.
Your white handkerchief, madam!
I thought, sir, I wasn't to use that till heart-rending woe.
Oh, no, madam, at the finches of the grove, if you please.
Nor lark, linnet, nor all the finches of the grove.
Vastly well, madam.
Vastly well indeed.
For oh, too sure, heart-rending woe is now the lot of wretched Tilburina.
Oh, tis too much.
Tis indeed.
Oh, be comforted, sweet lady, for who knows but heaven has yet some milk-white day in store.
Alas, my gentle Nora, thy tender youth as yet hath never mourned love's fatal dart. Else wouldst thou know that when the soul is sunk in comfortless despair, it cannot taste of merriment.
That's certain.
But see, where your stern father comes, it is not meet that he should find you thus.
What the plague? What a cut is here! Why, what has become of the description of her first meeting with Don Whisker Anvils?
His gallant behavior in the sea fight and the simile of the canary bird.
Indeed, sir, you will find they will not be missed.
Oh, very well, why?
The cue, ma'am, if you please.
It is not meet that he should find you thus.
Thou counselest right, but 'tis no easy task for bare-faced grief to wear a mask of joy.
How is this? In tears? Oh, Tilburina, shame. Is this a time for maudlin tenderness and Cupid's baby woes? Hast thou not heard that haughty Spain's Pope-consecrated fleet advances to our shores, while England's fate, like a clipped guinea, trembles in the scale?
Then is the crisis of my fate at hand. I see the fleet's approach. I see...
Now, pray, gentlemen, mind. This is one of the most useful figures we tragedy writers have, by which a hero or heroine, in consideration of their often being obliged to overlook a number of things that are on the stage, is allowed to hear and see a number of things that are not.
There's a kind of poetical second sight.
Yes. Now then, madam.
I see their decks are cleared. I see the signal made. The line is formed, a cable's length asunder. I see the frigate stationed in the rear. And now I hear the thunder of the guns. I hear the victor shout. I also hear the vanquished groan. And now 'tis smoke. And now I see the loose sail shiver in the wind. I see what soon you'll see.
Hold, daughter, peace. This loveth turn thy brain. The Spanish fleet thou canst not see, because it is not yet in sight.
Yet again, the governor seems to make no allowance for this poetical figure you talk of.
No, plain matter of fact, man, that's his character.
But will you then refuse his offer?
I must, I will, I can, I ought, I do.
Think what a noble price.
No more you urge in vain.
His liberty is all he asks.
All who asks?
In answer, I can't tell. Why, here has been such a cutting and slashing. Don't know where I've got to myself.
Indeed, sir, you will find it will connect very well, and your reward secure.
Oh! If they had not been so devilishly free with their cutting here, you would have found that Don Whisker Andos has been tempering for his liberty and has persuaded Tilburina to make this proposal to her father. And now, pray, gentlemen, observe the conciseness with which the argument is conducted. Egad, the pro and con goes as smart as hits in a fencing match.
A retreat in Spain.
Outlaw here.
Your daughter's prayer.
Your father's oath.
My lover.
My country.
Tilburina.
England.
A title.
Honor.
A pension.
Conscience.
£1,000.
Ah, thou hast touched me nearly.
Nearly, get you see? She threw in £1,000 and the palpable hit he got.
Canst thou reject the suppliant and the daughter too?
No more. I would not have thee plead in vain. The father softens. But the governor is fixed.
Aye, that antithesis of persons a very established figure.
Tis well. Hence then, fond hopes, fond passion hence. Beauty, behold, I am all over thine.
Where is my love? My beauteous enemy.
Oh, dear, you must start a great deal more than that. Consider, you had just determined in favor of duty. When, in a moment, the sound of his voice revives your passion, overthrows your resolution, destroys your obedience. If you don't express all that in your start, you do nothing at all.
Well, we'll try again.
Speaking from within has always a fine effect.
Where is my love? My beauteous enemy, my conquering Tilburina. How? Is't thus we meet? Why are thy looks averse? What means that falling tear, that frown of boding woe? Ah, now I am indeed a prisoner. Yes, now I feel the galling weight of these disgraceful chains, which, cruel Tilburina, thy doting captive gloried in before, but thou art false. And Whiskers is undone.
Oh, no, how little dost thou know thy Tilburina.
Art thou then true? Begone, cares, doubts, and fears. I make you all a present to the winds. And if the winds reject you, try the waves.
The wind, you know, is the established receiver of all stolen sighs and cast-off griefs and apprehensions.
Yes, yes. Yet must we part. Stern duty seals our doom. Oh, here I call yon conscious clouds to witness. Could I pursue the bias of my soul? All friends, all right of parents I disclaim. And thou, my Whiskerandos, shouldst be father and mother, brother, cousin, uncle, aunt, and friend to me.
Oh, matchless excellence, and must we part? Well, if we must, we must. But in that case, the less is said, the better.
Hey, Dave, here's a cut. What? Are all the mutual protestations out?
Oh, please, sir, don't interrupt us just here. You'll ruin our feelings.
Your feelings? Zoons! My feelings, Bob.
Pray, don't interrupt them.
One last embrace.
Now, farewell forever.
Forever?
Aye. Forever.
Step and fury! Get light! Sir! Madam! If you go out without the parting look, you might as well dance out here!
But pray, sir, how am I to get off here?
You? What the devil signifies how you get off? Edge your way at the top, or where you will. Now then, madam!
We understand you, sir. Aye, forever.
Charming.
Age is pretty well, I think. You see, I don't attempt to strike out anything new, but I take it I improve upon the established modes.
You do indeed. But pray, is not Queen Elizabeth to appear?
No, not once. But she is to be talked of forever, so that egad you will think 100 times she's on the point of coming in.
Hang it, I think it's a pity to keep her in the green room all the night.
Oh, no, that always has a fine effect, for it keeps up expectation.
But are we not to have a battle?
Yes, you will have a battle at last, but it is not to be by land, but by sea, and that is the only quite new thing in the piece.
What? Drake at the Armada, eh?
Yes, in faith, fire ships and all. And then we shall end with a procession. Hey, that will do, I think.
No doubt, aunt.
Come, we must not lose time. So now for the underplot.
What the plague, have you another plot?
Oh, Lord, yes, ever while you live, have two plots to your tragedy. Mm. The grand point in managing them is only to let your underplot have as little connection with your main plot as possible. Yes. Now, I flatter myself, nothing could be more distinct than mine. For as in my chief plot, all the characters are great people, I have laid my underplot in low life. And as the former is to end in deep distress, I make the other end as happy as a fart. Well, Mr. Hopkins, as soon as you please.
Sir, the carpenters say it is impossible that you go to the park scene yet.
The park scene? Yes. No. I mean, the description scene here in the wood.
Oh, excuse me. Sir, the performers have cut it out.
Cut it out?
Yes, sir.
What, the whole account of Queen Elizabeth?
Yes, sir.
And the description of her horse and side saddle?
Oh, yes, sir.
No, this is very fine indeed. Mr. Hopkins, how the plague could you suffer this?
Oh, sir, indeed, the pruning knife.
The pruning knife?
Yeah, the pruning
knife. Zounds, the axe! Why, here has been such a lopping and topping, I shan't have the bare trunk of my play left presently. So, this is very fine indeed. Very well, sir. The performers must do as they please. But upon my soul, I'll print it every word.
That I would indeed.
Very well, sir, then we must go on. Zounds! I would not have parted with a description of the horse. Well, sir, go on. Sir, it was one of the finest and most labored things. Very well, sir. Let them go on. There you had him, and his accoutrements from the bit to the crupper. Very well, sir, then we must go to the park scene.
Sir, there is the point. The carpenters say that unless you put in some extra business here before the drop, they shan't have time to clear away the fort and sink Gravesend in the river.
So, this is very fine indeed.
Gentlemen, you must excuse me. These fellows will never be ready unless I go and look after them myself.
Yes, these little things will happen.
To cut off this scene. But I'll print it. Egad, I'll print it every word.
Gentlemen, if you have any on-tract music, you better play it now. This may take some time.
I can scarcely play the part of Whisker Randos without them.
This, I suppose, is a sort of Senate scene.
To be sure, there has not been one yet.
It's the underplot, isn't it?
Yes. What, gentlemen, do you mean to go at once to the discovery scene?
If you please, sir.
Oh, very well. Harkee, I don't choose to say anything more, but if faith they have mangled my play in the most shocking manner.
Oh, it's a great pity.
So then, Mr. Justice, as soon as you please.
Are all the volunteers without?
They are. Some 10 in fetters and some 20 drunk.
Attend the youth whose most opprobrious fame and clear convicted crimes have stamped him soldier.
He waits your pleasure, eager to repay the blessed reprieve that sends him to the fields of glory, there to raise his branded hand in honor's cause.
His well, 'tis justice arms him. Oh, may he now defend his country's laws with half the spirit he hath broke them all. If it be your worship's pleasure, bid him enter.
I fly, the herald of your will.
Quick, sir! Go quick!
But I think, Mr. Papp, not only the justice, but the clown seems to talk in as high a style as the first hero among them.
Heaven forbid he should not in a free country. Sir, I am not one for making slavish distinctions and giving all the fine language to the upper sort of people.
Oh, that's very noble in you indeed.
Now pray mark this scene.
Forgive this interruption, good my love, but as I just now passed the prisoner youth whom rude hands hither led, strange boding seized my fluttering heart, and to myself I said, and if our Tom had lived, he'd surely been this stripling's height.
Aha! Sure, some powerful sympathy directs us both. What is thy name?
My name's Tom Jenkins. Alias have I none, though orphaned and without a friend.
My parents!
My father dwelt in Rochester and was, as I have heard, a fishmonger. No more!
What, sir? Do you mean to leave out your account of your birth, parentage, and education?
They have settled it so, sir, here.
Oh!
How loudly nature whispers to my heart! Had he no other name?
I'd seen a bill of his signed Tompkins, creditor.
This doth indeed confirm each circumstance the gypsy told. Prepare!
I do!
No orphan, nor without a friend art thou. I am thy father. Here's thy mother, there thy uncle, this thy first cousin, and those are all your near relations.
Oh, ecstasy!
almost unlooked for happiness.
Oh, wonderful event!
There you see, relationship like murder will out.
Oh, let's revive, elsewhere this joy too much. But come, and we'll unfold the rest within. And thou, my boy, must needs want rest and food. Hence may each often hope, as chance directs, to find a father where he least expects.
Well, what do you think of that?
One of the finest discovery scenes I ever saw. Why, this underpot would make a tragedy in itself.
Aye, or a comedy either.
And keeps quite clear, you see, of the other. The scene remains, does it?
Yes, sir.
Oh, yes, but you are to leave one chair, you know. But it is always awkward in a tragedy to have you fellows coming in your playhouse liveries to remove things. I wish that could be better managed. So, now, for my mysterious yeoman.
Perdition catch my soul, but I do love thee.
Haven't I heard that line before?
No, I fancy not. Where, please?
I think there's something like it in Othello.
Egad, now you put me in mind, don't I believe there is? Oh, but that's of no consequence. All that can be said is that two people happened to hit upon the same thought, and Shakespeare made use of it first, that's all.
Very true.
Yes. Now for your soliloquy. But speak more to the pit, if you please. The soliloquy, always to the pit. That's a rule.
Though hopeless love finds comfort in despair, it never can endure a rival's bliss. But soft! I am observed.
That's a very short soliloquy.
Yes, but it would have been a great deal longer if he'd not been observed.
A most sentimental BP to that, Mr. Buff.
Harkee! I would not have you be too sure. He is a beef eater.
What a hero in disguise.
No matter. I only make a hint. But now, for my principal character. Here he comes, Lord Burleigh. Pray, gentlemen, step this way, softly. I only hope the Lord High Treasurer is perfect. Oh, if he is but perfect. Mr. Buff, shh! Vastly well, sir. Vastly well. Most interesting gravity. What? Is he not to speak at all? Gad, I thought you'd ask me that. Yes, it is a very likely thing that a minister in his situation, with the whole affairs of the nation on his head, should have time to talk. But shh, or you'll put him out.
Put him out? How the plague can that be if he's not going to say anything?
There's a reason why his part is to think. And how the plague do you imagine he can think if you keep talking?
That's very true, upon my word. Shh.
is very perfect indeed. But pray, what did he mean by that?
You don't take it?
No, I don't, upon my soul.
Why, by that shake of the head, he gave you to understand that even though they had more justice in their cause and wisdom in their measures, yet, if there was not a greater spirit shown on the part of the people, the country would at last fall a sacrifice to the hostile ambition of the Spanish monarchy.
What the devil? Did he mean all that by shaking his head?
Every word of it. If he shook his head as I taught him...
Well, there certainly is a vast deal to be done upon the stage by damn show and expression of face, and a judicious author knows how far he may trust to it.
Ah, here are two of our old acquaintance.
My niece and your niece, too? By heaven, there's witchcraft in it. He could not else have gained their hearts. But see where they approach. Some horrid purpose lowering on their brow.
Let us withdraw and mark them.
What is all this?
Ah, here has been more pruning. Oh, but the fact is that these two young ladies are also in love with Don Whiskerandos. Oh. Now, gentlemen, this scene goes entirely for what we call situation and stage effect, by which the greatest applause may be obtained without the assistance of language, sentiment, or character. Pray mark.
Eleanor here? She is his scorn as much as I. That is some comfort still.
Oh, dear madam. You must not say that to her face. Aside, ma'am. Aside. The whole scene is to be aside. Oh.
She is his scorn as much as I. That is some comfort still.
I know he prizes not Paulina's love, but Tilburina lords it o'er his heart.
But see, the proud destroyer of my peace revenges all the good I've left.
He comes, the false disturber of my quiet. Now, vengeance, do thy worst.
Oh, hateful liberty, if thus in vain I seek my Tilburina.
And ever shalt.
Oh! Hold! We will avenge you!
Hold you! Or see your nieces bleed! Oh,
there's a situation for you! Ha ha! There's an heroic group! You see, the ladies can't stab Whiskerandos. He durst not strike them for fear of their uncles. The uncles durst not kill him for fear of their nieces. I have them all at a deadlock, for every one of them is afraid to let go first.
Why, then they must stand there forever.
So they would, if I hadn't a fine contrivance for it. Oh. Now, mine.
In the Queen's name, I charge you all to drop your swords and daggers.
That's a contrivance indeed.
I, in the Queen's name.
Come, peace.
Come, peace. What's he that bids us thus renounce our guard?
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thou must do more. Renounce thy love.
Thou liest, base beef eater!
Ha! Hell! The lie! By heaven, thou hast roused the lion in my heart! Off, yeoman's habit! Base disguise! Off! 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 Am I a beef eater now? Or beams my crest as terrible as when in Biscay's Bay I took thy captive sloop?
There you see he comes out to be the very captain of the privateer who had taken Don Whiskerandos prisoner and was himself an old lover of Tilburina's.
Admirably managed, indeed.
Now stand out of their way, Dick. Yes.
I thank thee, Fortune, that has thus bestowed a weapon to chastise this insolent.
I take thy challenge, Spaniard.
And I thank thee, Fortune, too.
That's excellently contrived. It seems as though the two uncles had left the swords for them on purpose.
Oh, no. They could not help leaving.
Vengeance and Tilburina!
Exactly so. That last thrust in Tyus was fatal. Captain, thou hast fenced well, and with Carandos quits this bustling scene for all eternity.
He would have added, but stern death cut short his being and the nun at once.
Oh, my dear sir, you are too slow. Sir, I shall trouble you to die again.
Edwis Carandos quits this bustling scene for all eternity.
Nitty. He would have added.
No, sir, that's not it.
No.
Now, once more, if you please.
Sir, I must ask you to practice this without me. I can't stay here dying all night.
Very well. We'll go over it by and by. Yes, I must humor these fellows.
Farewell, brave Spaniard. And when next we
My
meet...
My dear sir, you need not speak that speech, as the body has walked off.
That's true, sir. Then I join the fleet.
If you please. Now who comes on?
A hemisphere of evil planets reign, and every planet sheds contagious frenzy. My Spanish prisoner is slain. My daughter meeting the dead corse born alone hath gone distract. But hark! I am summoned to the fort. Perhaps the fleets have met. Amazing crisis! O Tilburina, from thy aged father's beard thou'st plucked the few brown hairs which time had left.
Poor old gentleman.
Yes, and no one to blame but his own daughter.
And the planets.
True. Now enter Tilburina.
Egad, the business comes on quick here.
Yes, now she comes in stark mad in white satin.
Why in white satin?
Oh, Lord, sir, when a heroine goes mad, she always goes into white satin. Don't she, Dangle?
Always, it's a rule.
Yes, here it is. Enter Tilburina, stark mad in white satin. And her confidant, stark mad in white linen.
What the devil is the confidant to be mad to?
To be sure she is. The confidant is always to do whatever her mistress does. Weep when she weeps, smile when she smiles, go mad when she goes mad. Now then, Madam Confidant, but keep your madness in the background, if you please.
The wind whistles. The moon rises. See, they've killed my squirrel in his cage. Is this a grasshopper? No, it is my whiskerandos.
You shall not keep him. I know you have him in your pocket. An oyster may be crossed in love. Who says a whale's a bird? Ah, did you call, my love? He's here! He's there! He's everywhere! Oh, me! He's nowhere!
There! Do you ever desire to see anyone madder than that?
Never while I live.
You observed how she mangled the meter.
Yes, again, it was the first thing made me suspect she was out of her senses.
But pray, what becomes of her?
She's gone to throw herself into the sea, to be sure. That brings us at last to the scene of action and to my catastrophe. My sea fight, I mean.
But you bring that on at last.
Yes. Mm. Well, you know my play is called the Spanish Armada. Otherwise, egad, I have no occasion for a battle at all. Now then, for my magnificence, my noise, my battle, and my procession. You are all ready?
Yes,
is the Thames dressed?
No! Oh.
Oh. Oh. Beware! Deeds! See, gentlemen, there's a river for you. This is blending a little of the mask with my tragedy, a new fancy, you know, and very useful in my case. For as there must be a procession, I suppose that Thames and all his tributary rivers to compliment Britannia with a fete in honor of the victory.
But who are these gentlemen in green with him?
Those. Those are his banks.
His banks?
Yes, one crowned with alders, the other with a villa. But hey, what the plague? You've got both your banks on one side. Here, sir, come round. Thames, ever while you live, go between your banks. There. So now for it, my dear friends. Away, Thames!
And guardian angels sang this strain. shall to thy happy coast repair. Best I'll with matchless beauty crowned, and merry hearts who dance.
Lucky.
For God's sake, gentlemen! What are you doing? You scuttle the spirit of the nation!
Tis only temporary, Mr. Pop. She'll rise again when the seamen have studied the cue.
Then give thanks, sir. The nation's security depends on the Navy, not the seamen.
The Navy has more rehearsal.
Bop!
I feel very silly just sitting here and going up and down. I am used to speaking parts.
But, madam, I have contrived it. You are the center of attention.
Well, that's something, I suppose. But a little prologue wouldn't come amiss.
Oh, ready now, Mr. Puff, for your procession and the grand march.
Then strike up, gentlemen! Now you will see something, my grand finale!
Mr. Puff, it can scarce surpass what we've already seen.
I hope, sir, that it may!
Thank you.
pretty well. Not quite perfect. So, ladies and gentlemen, if you please, we'll rehearse this piece again tomorrow.
Open the door, you rascals. The claret is finished, and so is the play.
Thank God, Dick, you've run it damn close this time.
What are you talking about? You have at least 48 hours. Actors, you know, can do anything. More's the pity. Am I to be allowed home now, or must I watch the damn thing, too?
Tomorrow, sir, when we are perfect.
Nothing, Mr. King, in the whole history of the theatre has ever been perfect. If it were, no one would bother to come. Good night.